Now let's kick off our first theme now. It's called Innovative Export Marketing. Now, exporters have seen an incredible amount of change in export marketing channels over the last 20 years, moving from the traditional methods of export marketing to the wide range of avenues now available and accessible to reach potential customers, providing unique opportunities and challenges to connect your companies and products to the customer. Now, the growth of social media, the Facebooks, the Twitters, the Tumblrs and the YouTubes, and new technologies such as smartphones and tablets provide a myriad of opportunities to connect with customers in new ways, whenever and wherever, at the same time providing an opportunity to gain a better insight into customer motivations, aspirations, and ultimately why they choose your products or services. Now, our speakers in the Innovative Export Marketing theme represent incredibly innovative companies. They've broken new ground across the supply chain and continue to innovate daily to grow market share and stay ahead of the competition. I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker for this first theme, Grant Ryan, the founder of SLI and Yike Bike. Now, Grant is an addicted inventor, a bold risk taker and an entrepreneur. He's founded a number of companies, including Global Brain Net, Real Contacts, e-commerce search company SLI Systems, and Eurexta. He has a degree in mechanical engineering and a PhD in ecological economics from Canterbury University, and is on the board of the Canterbury Development Corporation and the Ministry of Science and Innovation's Advisory Board. His latest invention is the Yike Bike, an extraordinarily compact and innovative mode of transport which perfectly combines his love of mechanics, the environment, and innovation. Grant is highly ambitious for his Yike Bike. His dream is to make it the most commonly owned transport device in the world one day. And one British writer memorably described the Yike Bike as the extraordinary love child of a Segway and a penny farthing with dwarfism. When the Yike was unveiled to the world at the Eurobike trade fair a few years ago, the international media absolutely loved it, with big splashes in UK broadsheets, the coverage on Good Morning America and CNN, and other major European news shows. Grant has learned through experience the key factors that make the difference between export success and failure. Welcome, Grant.
Cheers. I'm always a little bit kind of sceptical about being invited along to this as some sort of expert around exporting. I remember very vividly the first time I ever got asked to be involved as an expert. Someone from the government called me up and they said, Grant, would you like to be on an expert ICT panel? And that was quite an easy decision for me because I figured a minimum requirement was to know what ICT stood for. I didn't know, but anyway. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you a few stories about exporting. So there's lots of different ways of doing it. And so rather than say this is how you do it, I'll just tell you some stories, some of the things that have worked, some of the things that haven't worked, and you can take from it what you will. But I love exporting. Anyone who exports, has a go at exporting, tries, is heroic as far as New Zealand Inc. is concerned, because we've got to earn our way in the world. So I get great joy when I see Yike Bike shipped off to 40 countries around the world, and it just feels like a good thing to be doing, and I love it. So what I'm going to do to start off with is a little bit experimental. So I've been involved in lots of companies, both my own with starting them up and seeing lots of others. I've been trying to work out what's the difference between success and failure. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you three different examples of a successful and a company that failed, and then I'll tell you my little interpretation of the difference. And it's not necessarily always going to work. So company A had a multi-million dollar license after just 11 months. After 2 years, sold for $50 million, has to be wildly successful. Company B, same sort of kind of space it was playing in. After 3 years, had grown to 35 people, but had to make them all redundant. And it lost tens of millions of shareholder value. Obviously, not very successful. So this is a different example. Company C and D, so this one grew more unique users than Trade Me in less than 12 months. Had a large offer from Google to buy it after 2 years, so you know, pretty successful. Company D, again, very similar space and time. Within 3 years, all 22 staff had to be let go, and around 10 million of venture capital was lost, so that's not very good either. And again, here's a comparison of a successful and a non-successful. So this is the last one, and then I'll tell you my little interpretation. So three people worked on it for 28 months, and a few hundred thousand dollar investment turned into a eight-figure cash exit. So investors got 10 to 20 times their money back, pretty damn successful. And this other one was very kind of similar space, never got more than a few thousand in sales, and missed a great big opportunity. So the difference between success and failure, I think, is nothing. Each of those companies was the same company. Those were my three first startup companies. So one of the things that most people who are wildly successful will tell you about is they have wildly large failures. It's an inevitable part of playing the game. It's like the opposite of success is not failure. The opposite of success and failure is boring mediocrity. You kind of don't get one without the other. So hopefully, as you learn, don't worry too much about the things that you fail with. The biggest failures that you ever get, only people who are wildly successful get to have great big failures. They kind of go hand in hand. And I've always loved this next video, so I'll just show you this. Kind of summarise it a little bit as well.
I've missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. I've failed over and over and over again in my life. And that is why I succeed.
Now, sorry if that makes you want to go and buy some sneakers. But I've always just loved that kind of story because it's kind of true. Because we have an unusual, I've spent a lot of time in the US, and we do have an unusual attitude to failure in New Zealand. It's just an inevitable part of trying really hard. You will fail. So that's kind of just a little kickoff. So, you know, some of the things I kind of want to talk about is, you know, if you read the business papers, you go, the most important thing about business is what's happening to the interest rates and the exchange rates and the little fluctuations in shareholder price. And the thing that kind of strikes me about business is it's a wildly creative space. You only have to do two things. You have to create something that someone wants to pay some money for, and you have to be able to make it for less than that, and you try and make the gap as big as possible for as long as possible. But apart from that, there's so much you can do. I'm always blown away by the creative ways that people can, you know, create businesses. And it really is a wildly creative space. So what I'm going to do is just tell you, I guess, a couple of little stories. So I've created five multi-million dollar export companies to date. And I wanted to kind of tell you a little bit more about the latest two that I'm kind of working on. So in none of them I've been able to work out exactly who and where we'll sell to. And either, you know, maybe I'm not too bright, but bit of advice I got that I really liked was the idea that you light lots of fires, and the ones that work you throw gasoline on, and the ones that don't worry about. I've never been able to guess exactly how it'll work, so you just try lots of things really cheaply and inexpensively, and then you kind of see what works and you do more of it. So this is an example of a company. This was one that we sold into the US during the dot-com boom, and we bought it back because we just thought it was great technology. It helped people search. Now, we had our first customers. We did company intranets, we did councils, we had airlines, we had tech companies, we had e-commerce customers. And then we found this little sweet spot in e-commerce customers because basically, if they turned our search on, they'd sell more stuff. So we had a great argument we could go to them. And then we were trying to work out, well, how do we touch our customers? And we found this trade show. This was our first one about 9 years ago. I just kind of wanted to show it as a comparison because this was us this year. So this was, you know, we spend a fortune on this show. This is internet retailer in the US. They have 500 vendors there, and SLI is the biggest contributor. There's signs at the airport when you land, there's everything. And we don't do that because it's not a risk for us, because we know last year we got way more money out of that than we did, than it cost us. So this is where our people, has anyone here heard of SLI Systems? There's a couple. Have any of you heard of Yike Bike? Yeah. Well, SLI is way more successful than Yike Bike. And it does way better marketing because we know exactly who buys SLI Systems and you guys don't, so we don't care that you don't know about it. Whereas Yike Bike, the media just loves it for some reason and they do lots of stories on it. So we know exactly who our customers are, we know where they go, and so we go and see them. So this is this just kind of shows who are the top providers of e-commerce search to the top retailers in the US. And so top is Oracle, SLI Systems is number two, Adobe's number three. Further down the list is Google, and there's a Microsoft product, and there's an IBM product. And we're the fastest growing on that list. We're going to overtake Oracle because it's a competitor they bought, and now they don't really focus on it. So, you know, you kind of say, well, how can a little Christchurch company compete with Google on search or any of these things? And the thing is, we focus on it completely and totally. That's all we do. We are the experts. And it's kind of one of these things that, again, we didn't guess. It's not just the technology, but one of the reasons we win is that there's a global shortage of IT people. And the companies we work with, they want a solution quickly, and we do the whole thing, and we do it for them. And Google doesn't do, you know, services, they only provide a product. So we've got this beautiful little niche. We own about 6% of it, growing 30, 40%, got over 100 people. It's just going gangbusters. I would love to claim more credit. I'm just one of the founders and investors and directors, very happy investor, but I haven't been involved operationally, which is probably why it's going so well. Now, this is the one that everyone knows about, and that's just because the media's got nothing very interesting to tell us, so they leap into anything vaguely interesting. So, but this is, I just thought I'd tell you about the Yike bike. Now, you were supposed to be getting a talk from Jeff Ross on international branding, and he would have done a much better job than me, but I just wanted to tell you a little bit of a story about why I chose to do the Yike bike, because I have this list of literally 200 things that I could do, and I chose this partly because it's always easy to create a business that you're excited about, but you underestimate the cost of sales. So I kind of like the idea of a product that when it was used, people would see it, they'd see what it was, and they'd go, wow, that'd be great. So we designed something that we knew hundreds of people would see if it was being used and it'd have Yike Bike on it. So we want to create this, you know, great global brand out of Yike Bike. Whether we pull it off or not is something else, but we kind of thought about, even before we decided to do it, we thought about how would you go about selling a product. And then I was told to talk about social media, so it's not something I'm hugely can tell you an awful lot about, but this is just an example. We put up a YouTube video of the Yike, 1.3 million hits on it. So basically, if you kind of create something that people think is interesting and viral, you know, they'll send it around. It's kind of easy with a product like that, which is partly why I said why I chose it. But basically, it's another media. If you don't know how to do it, hire someone young and get them to do it. That's what I do. But it, you know, it's a great tool that everyone should use. A little bit about intellectual property. There's a few people who will know this in the room, but intellectual property as a market is booming. Like the number of sales of licenses and IP, and you can do it from New Zealand as good as anywhere else. Now, it's not for every sort of business, and I only tell you this kind of I don't like saying this because some people might just jump into writing patents, but we had one where, you know, this little document we sold, people say, well, why would you have a patent? The big guys will just kind of rip you off. But basically, we had this patent. It was a very core part of kind of social networking, and we sold it to a top 10 US tech company that we still can't say which one. But, you know, that was worth over $1 million per page of text. And I'm like, you know, that's kind of, there's no barrier to not being able to do that from New Zealand. They don't care. And it's like, why did they pay us that? Are they scared of us? No. We just go and we say, you're going to have it or your competitor will have it, and they bid for it. Now, you can kind of, if you like that intellectual property or not, it's just that's a market that exists that you can play in if you want to. There's no point kind of struggling against how the world is. You can say this is the rules and you can play by it if you want. But we can play that game from here if we want to. And I personally love intellectual property. And I always will. Now, this one, I just wanted to show you a little bit of an evolution of the Yike bike, because some people kind of assume it kind of plopped out fully formed, but this is kind of a history of how it was developed, because creating a great product, I think, is cool. But so this kind of, it starts with a hunch. I had this hunch that there should be something inherently smaller than a bike that you could fold up that, you know, would be stable. So we had no idea if we would work it out. So again, it's like lighting lots of fires. You try lots of little things really rapidly. So these first prototypes, you can see, they're kind of designed so we can try lots of things. We had no idea how you'd steer it, how the wheels would work, how it would link together. That's a little electrical connection so we could try lots of things. We didn't know if it was handlebars or we did try a joystick, but that wasn't going to work for lots of reasons. Wouldn't look very good. Skateboard wheels on the back here. Caleb's always been called the tree hugger after that little thing. So, but you see, it started with pedals, and the yoke bike doesn't have pedals. But I figured you got big muscles, why wouldn't you want to use those? But we wanted to make this thing super small and light. And so what happened is you needed your pedals, you needed your gearbox. And so you can kind of see it starting to evolve from the handlebars back here to the, you know, just naturally down like this. You can start to see how we're starting to think about how it folds up into a tiny little space. And again, we're doing lots of quick little iterations inexpensively. This is our first version where we chucked a motor on, and we kind of had the idea for a motor, and within a week we had a prototype. We just wanted to see how does it going to feel when you've got a motor on it. Yes, that's a drill slip to the side. You don't have to engineer, you know, a little motor if you can just buy one and chuck it on, test it out. Quick, cheap, rapid innovations. This is the first carbon fiber piece. I thought it was so cool. I did tell people I left it on my bedside cabinet and they accused me of sleeping with it, but anyway, I thought it was so cool. And then as you can see, the carbon's kind of starting to evolve. It's starting to kind of come towards this kind of final shape, but it's showing that it doesn't just plop out, you kind of do it with lots of rapid cycles. So again, this is you know, another step as we kind of get it more and more stable. So what we wanted to do is create something that we could ultimately throw anybody on, and within a few minutes they could learn how to ride it. And it was dramatically smaller and lighter and more compact than anything else. So, you know, by that we were on the cover of Time magazine that year as one of the best inventions of the year, and primarily because it looked a bit different. You know, there's lots of other really cool things out there. But like I said, so as far as the parts of the business, I kind of chose that because I thought that would be great because we get lots of media, lots of coverage. Guinness Book of World Records, didn't have to choose what to buy the family for Christmas that year. It was kind of easy. But now we've got to turn all that massive interest into, you know, making real things and selling them and shipping them. That's bloody hard, as all of you know who have to do that sort of thing. But it's kind of fun and it's hugely rewarding making real things. So both of those things, I guess I'd just like to, you know, Phil already talked about the micro niche, but just really focusing, laser-like focus. You find out something that works, and then you try and do more and more of it. And people say, well, what are you talking about, Grant? You do software and then you do a yike. What the hell are you focusing on? And well, what I do focus on is, I've worked out I'm not actually very good at operational companies. You know, it's not my forte. There's other people that are a lot better. But I love that little creative part at the start. Like for a lot of people, a startup's a painful, horrible thing that you have to go through before you've got a proper business, and then you've got a proper business and you can kind of get on with being a proper businessman. Whereas I just love that creative, unknown start part. So that's what I focus on. And hopefully I'm going to get better and better at it. And I've got a little team of people that help with all the little processes. And like anything, the first time, I mean, we just got so lucky with our first one that gave us some resource to try and get more and more bold with the next one. So anyway, I focus on little startups and I love it. I've got another few cooking, and they're kind of interesting, and I can't tell you about them, but anyway. So, what's our competitive advantage in New Zealand? You know, we're miles away from anything. You know, where are we, how can we kind of play in the world? So I look and I think, you know, each of the businesses that I've started, you couldn't have done 15 years ago. Just because of their internet connections, even the Yike Bike, the way that we work with people, suppliers all around the world, so basically our geographic thing is becoming less of an issue. It's way less of an issue. And I don't know if you guys are aware, but you know, high-tech exporting has just overtaken sheep and beef as the third biggest exporter. And it's just going to continue to grow because, you know, the barriers to that are so much lower. At SLI Systems, for example, you know, we earn tens of millions of export revenue, and there's, you know, there's not even noughts and ones that go out of New Zealand. All our servers are overseas. We just control them. And this trickle of money flows in return for, it's a beautiful business. but we can do that from here. And as far as the, you know, what do people think of, you know, New Zealand tech companies? Well, we just don't tell them. It's not like we lie. We just kind of, it is a US registered company and we have US salespeople. So most of our customers don't even know we're from New Zealand. And you can try and convince them the other case, but what if someone came up to you and they said, I've got this cool bit of technology, and they're like, where are you from? You say, I'm from Tonga. You'd go, really? Nice place for a holiday. Now, so they're no worse than us, because it could be cool from Tonga. So they're just as, you know, we're just as biased as they are, but there's no point fighting that. It's fascinating. We get a lot of our Australian customers see us at a US trade show, and then they're kind of almost horrified to think we're a New Zealand company. So this is another thing I just want to quickly talk about, because we talk about the disadvantages of all people going over to Australia, but actually there's probably no country in the world that has less issues with their neighbours than we do. I mean, they're kind of friendly, they let us beat them at quite a few sporting things. Now I'm from Invercargill originally, and they always worry about people going to Christchurch, and we worry about people going to Australia. Australians worry about people going to Europe and the US. But basically, they're a big friendly neighbour, and we can sell lots of stuff there. And that's the thing that amazes me. So their e-commerce has just started to rev up, and so now we're selling brilliantly in Australia with SLI systems. And it's much easier than any other market we've entered. So we've got this great big friendly neighbour that we can kind of try. So they're a good neighbour to have. And they're rich, so we can take their money and have some fun. So the other thing that I just wanted to mention briefly is, you know, what does New Zealand have to offer? You know, we worry about these people going to Australia, but no one really talks about all the other people that come in to choose New Zealand as a place to live. So we kind of call Yike and SLI the United Nations of Yike Bike, because there's people from all over the place. Now we're lucky that there's people, talented people, want to come to New Zealand. If you look at what we've got, it's what the world is short of. And it does surprise me how many New Zealand businesses don't make the most of, you know, some of the talented people we have. You know, we've got a Chinese person who is working for us in China, but he grew up in New Zealand, and you know, he's Kiwi-ified, and so it's just such a fantastic resource. And there's lots of people who don't make the most of all these talented immigrants. So long term, I guess I'm pretty optimistic. The other thing that we can do that I see a huge advantage is we can do things very rapidly and very inexpensively. One of the things we tried to do with one of my businesses, Eurexta, we tried to do the typical US thing. We raised about $10 million in overseas venture capital. We had a US CEO, and man, did they burn through that money. About 18 months, it was gone. It's just, and that's the way they do it over there, and you kind of can't fold it in aggregate. But at an individual thing, it's kind of hard. But we can, if I was doing the Yike Bike in the US, I know it would have cost at least three or four times as much. So we can kind of do things very inexpensively and quickly. And that's a huge advantage when you're trying to plan the space. And the last thing I just want to touch on, these two guys are two of my heroes. And the reason is, I mean, you'll know that's, you know, Peter Jackson and Angus Tait. You know, both of those guys and their teams created a $500 million industry around what their passion. You know, they were passionate about something. And if you said, Peter Jackson came up to you and said, well, we're going to create $500 million industry, and we're going to have more Oscars out of Wellington than any other place apart from Hollywood. I mean, it's laughably impossible. What Angus did creating the high-tech industry in Christchurch was the same. Now, not all of us are going to have as much impact as that, but it just kind of shows what is possible with a lot of passion, and you get a team around you, and it's kind of amazing. And I think I'm going to have to buy some glasses too, maybe. But anyway, that's my little story for now. If you've got any questions later on or whatever, come and have a chat. Cheers.